Okay, so we're here today at the Canada Science and Technology Museum, and we are going to have an interview with Mr. James Cooney, and the interviewer, as usual, will be William McRae. So we'll just begin with you stating your full name, please.
James Patrick Cooney, better known as Jim Cooney.
And where did you go to school?
Well, I went to a number of schools, but I guess the ones that I should most mentioned are the University of Toronto, where about 1971 I finished a master's in East Asian Studies, focused on classical Chinese literature, and a minor study of Sanskrit. I spent then a year at National Taiwan University, deepening my knowledge of classical Chinese, but also learning current spoken Chinese, Guayu or Mandarin. And I spent about a year in India as what I would call an itinerant scholar, pursuing Indian classical languages and literature. I also went to the University of British Columbia, was initially working on a doctorate where my thesis focus was going to be on some linguistic aspects of the translation of Buddhist sutras into Chinese during the Tang Dynasty, but deciding that that was not going to be an employable future, at least not one readily in demand, and having my first child on the way, I decided to switch paths and join the mining industry.
Okay, and what got you into the mining industry? I mean, because that's completely
That's not on the surface a relevant academic background, and I would say that almost nothing that I've done in my academic world has related directly to the mining industry, but a lot of it has related indirectly. My basic orientation in life is probably as a philosopher. I'm interested in the meaning of things and the purpose of life and various ethical and moral questions and various approaches to understanding the nature of humanity. And this has proven very interesting background for the mining industry because I've sometimes said, if you're of a philosophical disposition, there's no better place to position yourself than within a mining company, because not only are you dealing with the more fundamental philosophical questions of the relationship between humankind and the material universe, you're also dealing with a huge range of ethical concerns related to the impact on the environment, of the extraction of natural resources, the impact on communities, on a whole range of issues related to public policy and political priorities and so forth. So if you have a reflective disposition and an analytical orientation, mining is not a bad environment in which to practice those attributes or orientations.
So how did you get into mining, and what was the first job?
The first job, well, when I said I was interested in just finding some regular full-time employment and not being a part-time academic, as I was then being at UBC in the mid-1970s. I happened to have the good fortune of being hired by Cominco, which is a venerable Canadian mining company. It's now been absorbed into Teck Resources. But for many, many years, it was in the forefront of mining in Canada with a specific emphasis on mining zinc and lead, but it also got into copper and other metals over the years. And they had, of course, a major smelter operation in Trail, British Columbia. In 1975, Cominco, which was at that point a subsidiary or partial subsidiary of Canadian Pacific Enterprises, relocated its head office from Windsor Station in Montreal to Vancouver for a couple of reasons. One, to remove itself from all the uncertainties connected with the sovereignty movement in Quebec, but two, I think, to be closer to its primary operating facilities and Trail. So I went downtown and I met a person in this company who had an even more exotic background than myself. He had been on an Antarctic expedition and had done various other sorts of very unusual things. And we related, and he ended up offering me a job. He was part of a strategic planning group in Cominco, and this was made up of about half a dozen or so individuals of various types of academic backgrounds, not necessarily related to mining, but some had metallurgical or chemical engineering backgrounds, but there were also economists and business strategists and so forth. And in those days, Cominco had a very broad orientation with respect to its potential business interests. And so the role of the strategic planning group was to sort of scan the world, understand the future, and determine where some niche opportunities, or perhaps major opportunities, for Cominco might lie. So I was hired as a generalist, and my first title was information analyst. And the role was simply to take a subject that one of the fellows was working on and go out and research it and write up a little analytical paper on what I felt it was all about and what the potential implications for Cominco were. And so that's how I got into the business. And because I was able to write, they actually asked me during my first couple of years to do the company's annual report. And that's a very interesting way to get to know exactly what's going on in the company. So I would sit with the senior executives in the company, the president, CEO, who was then chairman of the board, and the senior executives, and they would talk about what they thought the important activities and accomplishments of the company had been during the past year, and then I would write up the overview. And that way I got to know what mining was all about, and particularly what Cominco's business was all about. But I should tell a story. The person who oversaw the strategic planning group at Cominco at that time was the then president. He wasn't CEO, but he was president of the company, and his name was Gerald H.G. Hobbs. And Gerald Hobbs actually came from a family that had founded a Canadian steel recycling industry in Vancouver called Western Canada Steel. And Cominco, back in the 70s, acquired Western Canada Steel. And as Gerald was the president of Western Canada Steel, they gave him the title of president of Cominco. But he was not a mining engineer, he was a business person, basically. But a person who was quite reflective and inquisitive with respect to the world around him. And so he's the person that sort of maintained the strategic planning group in the company to think about the future. So one day, I'd only been there about a month or 6 weeks or so, and I'd been introduced to him once. He calls and he says he'd like to have a conversation. So I prepare myself. In those days, you had to straighten your tie and make sure your jacket was right before you went up to the president's office. And I get up to his office and I sit down and he says, Jim, he says, I'm wrestling with a question. I'm thinking, this may be my last day in the mining industry because I really have only been here for a short time and don't know that much about this business. I'm sure I'm not going to be able to have an intelligent response to whatever he asked me. And then he posed the question. He says, I've been wondering. He says, what do you think the root causes of the Inquisition were? Well, I was back in my comfort zone. So we talked about the Middle Ages. I'd done some study of the Middle Ages in one part of my academic career. And the Crusades, and then the reversal from the Crusades into internal puritistic types of movements against the Albigensian heretics and Cathars and so forth. This is all very historical, and he sort of said, okay, all right, I guess I kind of understand what you're saying. But how did we get to the Inquisition? So I told him that, you know, this was an effort to sort of exile or expel the people that were not operating in a consistent manner with the more moralistic expectations of society as it then was. And he thanked me for that, and about a week later he said, you know, he says, I've been thinking about our conversation, and the Anglican primate in Toronto has asked me to give a presentation of the upcoming synod on business and Christianity. Could you put together some thoughts for me? So I wrote a paper, and he gave it, and it was an opportunity for me to do some research into writers that I had not previously explored, such as Reinhold Niebuhr and Jacques Ellul, and people who are quite known for taking an innovative approach to understanding the relationship of Christian ethical principles to society and the economy overall. And the speech scored, and they printed up 1,000 copies, and they distributed it to every Anglican church in Canada, and I was in like Flint, so to speak. But later on, upon reflecting on that, I came to realize why he had asked me that question, what were the root causes of the Inquisition. He didn't explain it to me at the time, and I'm not sure, since he was a somewhat intuitive, pathfinding type of thinker, whether he'd even formulated his question internally, that's explicitly for himself. But the main thing that he was seeing was that the mining industry was about to enter an inquisition, an inquisitorial period, where a lot of what it was doing came under serious question, from church groups, and then eventually they weren't so prominent in the 1970s, from non-governmental organizations, from academics, even from certain organs of the media. And so I began to realize that the job that I had was to muster the best defense possible in this inquisitorial process. I was basically, in some respects, you might say, the devil's advocate for the mining industry. and that's how I spent a good part of the rest of my career. I got a lot more specific then in terms of the other things I did, and sustainable development and so forth. But understanding the ethical norms that either governed or should govern decisions within the mining industry became a major sort of focus of my thinking as I continued in my career there. Any other questions?
You seem
transfixed.
Right, no, it's interesting. So from there, what became your next position?
Well, yeah, so I stayed with Cooney for 6 years, and during that time I had four different titles. Now, Cooney was a very interesting company. It was a multi-generational company. There were people that were working for Cooney when I joined, including the person that hired me reported to, who was a third-generation Cominconian. His grandfather had immigrated from Italy and worked in the lead smelter and trail in the 1890s, and his father had risen to be superintendent of the smelter, and he was then a vice president. And so, you know, three generations in the same company, a certain progression. And it was a company which is very rare today, but it was less rare in those days, that tended to hire the person rather than the skill. As industry evolved over the next 30 years or so, it was regarded as being much more managerially efficient simply to hire the skill. You retain the skill as long as you need that particular skill. Sometimes the person that possesses the skill has another skill that maybe will fill a slot as things evolve, and its earlier skill isn't so terribly needed. But more often than not, he would simply be dismissed. And so there's no sort of long-term loyalty or long-term connection to the company. I was fortunate in that Cominco, and then after that, Placer Development, which became Placer Dome, were both companies that were building a sort of organic collectivity that sort of went, you know, had a sense of internal loyalty. And it was in very difficult circumstances. Certainly some people were dismissed, but there was an effort to sort of find an opportunity for an individual and not simply sort of concentrate on the skill that he had at a particular time. And when it was perhaps no longer needed, to dismiss him. So Cominco offered me an enormous number of training opportunities. In about 1977, they were beginning to develop the Highland Copper Mine, which is now one of the major copper mining companies and copper mining operations in the world, and up in central British Columbia. And I don't know if it was Gerald Hobbs or one of the other people in the strategic planning group, but they said, you know, this has all sorts of complexities with respect to the social impact. I mean, there are a number of communities around there, Ashcroft, Cache Creek, Merritt, Kamloops, Logan Lake, and so forth. And we need to do some anticipation as to what our impact on those communities is going to be and how we should plan to sort of manage that impact. And so why don't you go off and take some courses and figure out how to do a socioeconomic impact study? So I went and did that and came back, and then I oversaw what was at that time, I think, the first socioeconomic impact study for any major mining project in British Columbia. And I have to reflect on that a bit, because at the time there were certain, as we then called them, Native Americans. We hadn't gotten to the point of using the term First Nations back in the 70s, who were virtually ignored. I think perhaps in this 250-page socioeconomic impact study we did, they may have had a page or two. The Cook's Ferry Band, or the Thompson River Indians, as they were known, and now called the Inklipamik First Nation. I was invited last year to take part in some dialogue exercises and negotiations between Cominco, then Tech Resources, and the Inklipamik First Nation to develop a mid-mine life agreement. And I told them that, you know, that socioeconomic impact study were being written today, it would be 80% about the interests of Aboriginal Canadians and 20% about the non-native communities. But it certainly wasn't that when I did it in the 1970s, so it just shows you how those things have evolved. And then there was issues around risk management. Cominco did not have a lot of operations in developing countries. It had one smelter operation in Kerala in India, which was disastrous, the Cominco Binani smelter operation. It was disastrous because it was a very sort of, left-leaning community that was where the workers were frequently on strike, not just for labor relations issues, but for political issues, and so there's a lot of hesitation about, you know, what. Also, I should say, in the there was a country, Central African Republic, where the president John Bedo Bokassa, who later became the emperor of the Central African Empire, and he was finally overthrown, decided that Cominco's diamond project in that country would be more beneficial if he owned it than if this foreign company owned it. And so he seized the diamond operation and threw the mine manager in jail. I remember one of the things I did was help negotiate the release of the mine manager. We never got the diamond mine back. But there's this high degree of suspicion about investing in foreign countries. And so I was asked to sort of develop an expertise in helping to manage the political risk around mining investments. And I did that. I had a lot of basic understanding of sociocultural dynamics from living abroad in a number of countries, and political dynamics from actually having studied political science at one point earlier on, and became basically what was regarded as the company's political risk analyst.
Okay.
And I remember that one of the papers I did at the time was on the Philippines. There was a copper opportunity for investment in the Philippines. I wrote a paper, it was early days of Ferdinand Marcos. He was only just, I think, becoming the dictator that he later became. But I told them it was going to be a very difficult operating environment. And the president, Gerald Hobbs, managed to sort of get the thing canceled. The executive vice president responsible for exploration, I don't think, ever forgave me for that. And that was the beginning of a long, complicated relationship I had with project enthusiasts who did not believe that there was any political risk that couldn't be managed effectively if you just sort of were smart enough. And to some extent, they were right, but they were often fooling themselves. You know, it led me to the conclusion that mining company management has an almost unlimited capacity for self-deception. They're really interested in developing something. And so my role was to sort of blow the whistle and try to sort of reduce the degree of self-deception insofar as possible. I never could say that I could countervail it completely. So I did political risk management, and then I also did strategic planning, and I got very involved in that. I went down to Stanford Research Institute in California, I know, and spent some time with them. They were constantly involved in future scenario development work and that sort of thing, and so I brought that into the company. So within those 6 years, I developed a portfolio of skills that were new and just sort of incoming as far as the mining industry was concerned, which gave me an interesting resume, which I made use of in 1982 when Placer Development, this other mining company in town, smaller than Cominco, but very energetic and very globally oriented, quite international in its interests, decided they needed somebody to manage government affairs and political risk and so forth. Particularly with the emergence at that time of environmental non-governmental organizations on the one hand, and First Nations assertiveness on the other hand. And so I joined Placer, left Cominco. I was reluctant to leave it in a sense because I was very happy there, though in retrospect it was absolutely the best thing for me to do. And I joined Placer Development, as it then was. It later became Placer Dome in 1986. But 1982, I joined Placer Development. And my title there was Manager Government Affairs. So that was the first time I had the title of manager in a mining company. Before, I was always an analyst or senior analyst. I was senior business analyst, senior project analyst, but never manager.
Yeah.
Don't know if I could have made that leap in Cooney. It might have been possible. Anyway, I did make that leap when I joined Plaza Development. And that put me into a different operating environment, which, as I said, was much more international.
What could you give examples of the international work or studies you conducted?
Yeah, well, I did a lot of studies. The Placer, and I'll just refer to it as Placer now. Placer had a long history in Papua New Guinea. Its very first mine had the Bulolo dredging operation, which was a Placer mining operation, whence the name of the company, started sometime in the 1920s. It was back in Papua New Guinea with some advanced exploration projects when I joined it, and they eventually became two mines in Papua New Guinea. As for countries that I have analyzed, certainly none is more socioculturally complicated or challenging than Papua New Guinea. And we had a mine in that eventually became the Misima mine on an island off the Louisiana archipelago to the southeast of mainland Papua New Guinea, and then one in the central highlands called Porgera. Misima is now closed, but Porgera is still operating, and even today it's a very controversial mine. Barrick is responsible for operating that, and it's been a very, very complex challenge. But also there were the Philippines. Placer, unlike Cooney, did invest in the Philippines about the time I was telling Cooney not to. And they had an operation called Mar Copper on the island of Marinduque. Now, one of the constraints of operating in the Philippines was that no foreign company was permitted to own more than 40% of a mine. And so it was difficult to have majority control or ownership. The people at Placer figured that they could just sort of find strategies that would enable them to influence the decision-making in that company, and they did. But that company in 1996, I believe it was, had a major environmental disaster, which became one of the more significant activities that I had to try to manage the company's way out of. It's called the Mar Copper Tailings Disaster.
It's the one with the river?
Yeah, it was the river. Yeah, it was. I don't know if you want me to go into that. It's quite a complex.
You could quickly
complex
describe the
situation. Well, so the mine had mined out the initial pit, which I think was called the Tapian Pit, and left a big hole inside the mountain. And a decision was taken in the late 1980s to develop an adjacent ore body, which was somewhat marginal economically. But the decision was taken, let's do it. And it was interesting, I was there when that decision was taken by the company. It was taken partly because they thought it wouldn't be a good idea to walk away from Mar Copper. There'd been so much sort of corporate goodwill, as it were, invested in that island. The electricity generating facility at the mine site actually supplied all the electricity to the island. It was a major source of business revenue for small businesses on the island. It employed quite a few people on the island. And it was thought, well, with the right management and so forth, this the San Antonio pit, as it's called, could be marginally profitable anyway. It could justify its existence. Historically, Mar Copper had a situation where, for complicated historical reasons, which I won't go into, the tailings disposal system was into an adjacent bay called Calican Bay, which wasn't that deep. It's only about, I think, 50, 70 feet deep, if I remember correctly, which had had a viable fishery that supported the community called the Calican community, I guess. And that became very controversial. Now, the reason why all that happened was this was during this Marcos dictatorship, and Imelda Marcos privately, and I only found this out later after the Marcos family was overthrown, was the majority shareholder of Mar Copper. And so they arranged for the tailings to be disposed in Calican Bay. And it was not a happy situation for the local fishing community there, that's for sure. It was controversial. Well, when the development of the Antonio Pit was proposed, it was agreed that the tailings could be deposited in the original Tappian Pit. And that was done, and that was regarded, therefore, as a relatively benign environmental operation. Except what had been ignored, and it was partly because Placid did not have very close information about some of the details of that operation, was that during the mining of the Tappian Pit, a tunnel had been built to provide for the removal of typhoon rainwater. Frequent typhoons put a lot of water into the pit, and drain that water into a neighboring river system, which was the Boac River and so forth. Then the disaster happened when the hydrostatic pressure on that tunnel, which had been blocked by Philippine engineers and not inspected by Placer. Our technical people could only go and work at Mark Hopper. They were invited by the Mark Hopper company, right? And in this case, they thought it was cheaper to use Philippine engineering firms rather than use the more expensive Canadian engineering firms for this tunnel blockage situation. So we didn't really have technical information on that as far as I was aware. And eventually the block of the tunnel failed and the tailings started gushing out that tunnel into the, it was originally, I think, the Macaloptic River, which flowed then into the Boac River system. And so I was told we have a disaster, and it was interesting. You know, one of the things that I had done for the company shortly after I joined, I guess, in the 1980s, no, it was actually a little bit later on, late 1990s, was to go around to all of Placer's operations in the world, which at that point were about 12, to install a crisis anticipation, crisis response system. But I was told by the CEO at the time, don't go to Mark Hopper because we don't formally manage that. Unless they ask you, then you can go. They never asked me, and so I never did. And ironically, it turned out that the one operation where Placer had its biggest disaster, its biggest crisis, was Mark Hopper, and they were totally unprepared. We had no system set up as to, you know, what the response mechanism should be, what the immediate communication system should be, you know, who needed to know what when, and so on and so forth. And so I got over there probably within 5 or 6 days of this happening. By that time, the tunnel had blocked itself up from the pressure of the tailings that were attempting to escape. And the Macaloptic River was like an airport tarmac. I walked, I think, a kilometer and a half down it, just on the surface, right? It was all the tailings had settled and hardened. Nobody had been killed in that accident, fortunately. Obviously, the river had been smothered, so whatever aquatic life was there was ended. And there may have been some damage to some farm animals. I'm not really sure. I think there was some damage to some farm animals, pigs and so forth. So the main risk to people of that situation was that if a typhoon were to come, the houses which had been, you know, fairly safe from the rushing river that would result from a typhoon were now at danger of being flooded because the river was filled. And so we had to do a relocation of a fair number of houses on the island. Most of the global NGO community got very excited. I mean, this sort of fit their agenda perfectly, you know, a major mining disaster. And so there was a huge amount of attention given to this situation. I should say, ironically, I helped mobilize an NGO myself in this respect because I thought, you know, when I got there and there's there's a major, major sort of social concern about this. All sorts of parties with all sorts of interests competing for attention. So I said, there must be somebody that has studied the society on this island, Marinduque, that I can use as an advisor. And I did a little bit of research and came across a woman anthropologist who then I think was teaching at Waterloo University, did her PhD at McMaster, living in Calican Bay and writing her thesis on the people of Calican Bay and their concerns about the mine and so forth. Her name is Catherine Cummins. For the first few months, we had quite a, I thought, potentially productive interaction as we tried to think of what the strategies might be to rectify the situation, not on the physical environmental side, that obviously was needed, but certainly on the social healing side. And her main concern was that the damage that had been caused to the residents of Calican Bay over the years by the earlier mining operations at Marcopper should be recognized and attended to, not just the damage that was caused by the people living on the other side of the mountain, who had never been what you might call stakeholders of the mine because they were not within the orbit of the direct impact of the mining operation, who were getting all the attention because they were immediately affected. So we had this situation that do we try to deal with all the problems of Marcopper right now, or just try to deal with the critical problems that have resulted from this particular tailings incident? And I was in favor of a more holistic approach, but the senior people in the company did not want to go any further than simply attending to the BOAC impact. And it came back primarily to the fact that the company was only a 40% equity shareholder. It did not actually control the board of the operation, nor did it control management. There was a Placer Dome person who had been seconded over to the Marcopper operation to act as mine manager. And there are a couple of three Placer Dome people and an 8-member board of directors for the Marcopper company. But A, we were participants in that, and if it were going to be an overall holistic response, the view in the company was that it had to be done by the shareholders in total of the Marcopper Corporation. This was in the post-Marcus area, and the major shareholder who owned the other 60% of the operation or something close to that was a guy named Ferdinand Bernardino, and he was totally uninterested in spending any money whatsoever, either in recompense or in environmental cleanup. And so, given the fact that Placer Dome was an international company with international reputational exposure and so forth, and I think because it was the right thing to do, our CEO made the decision that we would take 100% responsibility for responding to the tailings disaster, but not for everything that the mine had done and all the complaints against it that were more historical in nature. So that was a complication, and because of that complication, Catherine Cummins decided to go more on the aggressive and confrontational side. I believe that was probably something that she decided rightly in the interest of the concerns that were uppermost in her mind, which were the impact on the residents of the village around Calican Bay. And then other NGOs chimed in. I mean, we had church groups and so forth, and I spent quite a lot of time working with all these organizations to see if we could find some kind of strategy that would move the company forward towards a successful resolution of the issues. I guess I should wrap up this story, but eventually what happened was I was in favor of making the cleanup of the tailings a labor-intensive operation. We could probably have hired several hundred people with trucks and wheelbarrows and shovels and so forth. But our senior engineering people did not think that the company A could manage that sort of operation, nor did they think that it was without significant potential liability for anybody getting hurt or claiming, as was the case, claiming that they were poisoned or something by the tailings, or the tailings as such were not toxic. So we went for a heavy-duty mechanical way of cleaning up the river system brought in the world's largest dredging machine, built a trench at the foot of the BOAC River and washed the tailings down into the trench, covered them over, and so they were inert, and that was taken care of. We couldn't get rid of all the tailings that were beached along the riverbank, maybe amounting to less than 5% of the total, 2 or 3% perhaps, which could only be handled by a labor-intensive approach. So when we decided to withdraw from the Mark Hopper joint venture totally, and sell our remaining interest to Ferdinand Bernardino, we put a certain amount of money, as I recall, it was about $25 million, forward to cover the full cleanup of the river system. And he immediately turned it into a labor-intensive organization, of course. And he got all the credit for that. They would have, everybody was quite happy, everybody was employed. They would have an annual festival, or not an annual, a monthly festival to celebrate their good fortune that, you know, finally, you know, everybody was working. And that was the kind of image I was hoping that we could create had we gone for a labor-intensive approach, but perhaps it wasn't practical, I don't know, I can't say I was necessarily right on that. But it seemed like a good idea at the time, at least to me. And then as far as the NGO world was concerned, this really galvanized the NGO world, and the company actually, you know, before the Mark Hopper situation, I mean, I was very well aware of NGOs. Is one of the reasons I was hired at Placer in 1982 was because of the emergence of environmental NGOs, and this was 15 years later, and suddenly we were dead center as the focus of environmental NGOs and their concerns and complaints. But that that introduced the company's management overall to NGOs, and it was quite interesting. That started a major engagement with NGOs that Placer undertook. And if we were, you know, in our councils considering a potential investment in a project, and I'd be sitting at the table, CEO or somebody would say, well, what do you think the NGOs are going to want from this? What would be the NGO priority here? And I would, because I was fairly familiar with them and their issues and concerns, would be able to sort of say what I thought it was. Eventually we would find out for sure. So the NGOs got on the horizon as something that we had to work with. And it was in that same time frame that, for quite different historical reasons, I started introducing the idea of adopting a policy of sustainable development for the company. Now that goes back to the early 1990s. Sustainable development was enunciated at the Rio Earth Summit in 1992.
And I read your...
You read that, yeah. And following that, Canada adopted the policy theme of sustainable development, and the way of implementing that was to establish roundtables on the environment and the economy, which would bring together the various different perspectives, environmental, social, economic, and community, and so forth. And go through facilitated discussions to attempt to find common ground around major issues of concern, identify areas of difference, commission projects of research on those areas of difference, and so forth. So we established a national roundtable on environment and economy, which lasted up until about a year and a half, 2 years ago, when the government ended its existence, which was a very unwise move in my particular perspective. And each of the provinces established national roundtables. And I had the very good fortune in British Columbia, primarily because I was one of the few, or maybe almost the only person in the mining industry that had maintained reasonable conversational relationships with members of the New Democratic Party, which I thought was my duty to, in the role that I had with respect to managing public policy issues that could affect the industry, to be appointed by Premier Michael Harcourt to the BC Roundtable Environment and Economy. And so I was the person from the mining industry. There was somebody from forestry, somebody from tourism, somebody from hydroelectric developments and so forth. And then there were NGOs, environmental NGOs, there were community representatives, there were some Aboriginal representatives, and so forth. And we went through these facilitated discussions around different industrial sectors and different sort of general concerns like the future of Puget Sound and Georgia Strait, and so forth. But we never got to the mining industry. And eventually we were going to get there. It was almost the last major item left on the agenda. when Premier Harcourt decided that the roundtable had done enough and he wanted to move into a different forum of regional planning. And I was left with my preliminary thinking on what initiative related to mining and sustainable development would look like. So I took that to a meeting that was held in Spokane, Washington in late 1995, the meeting of the Northwest Mining Association, which the company was sponsoring, and I was asked to give a keynote speech. And my CEO suggested that I should do it on managing political risks, since that was what I'd been doing a lot of at that time. Mark Hopper had not yet occurred, but I was doing it in other countries for sure. And so I suggested in that speech that we needed to adopt, the mining industry generally needed to adopt a more holistic approach to managing its risk, because we did manage, you know, environmental risk with a certain set of principles and objectives and relationships and so forth. And we had managed our public policy risk with another set of principles, objectives, and relationships. And we managed the interactions with communities. But the rest of the world, in the aftermath of the Proclamation of Sustainable Development, was moving towards a more integrated approach, which meant that you don't simply consider these different types of challenges that exist for any kind of large industrial company, but particularly for a mining company, isolated from one another, but you see them as being related. And so you try to develop a balanced and integrated approach to considering the sociocultural dimensions, the environmental dimensions, the economic dimensions, which means that within the totality there could be some trade-offs in order to achieve the optimal combination of those various shared objectives. And the point I made was that unless we could get on this page, we were going to have difficulty in the public policy arena, not just working with a number of governments, even including Canada and the various provinces that adopted sustainable development as an overall sort of political vision, but in many developing countries and in the World Bank, which had also adopted this, which was a necessary ally in various developing countries around various projects, and agencies of the United Nations, which had, of course, originated the whole concept through the the initiative related to the environment and the economy in the Rio Convention that came out of that. And so that speech was greeted with a lot of negative reaction. I remember very clearly. I thought I had scored, and I'm surrounded by senior people from our company, and the senior vice president of exploration at the time says, "I think you're building a Trojan horse. You're bringing the enemy, our adversaries, inside our camp. You're going to weaken our resolve." Others said, "It sounds like capitulation to the NGOs." Some others said, "You know, aren't we going to be called hypocrites? We try to talk this way, you know, because we know we're not doing everything perfectly, very challenging business that we're in." But my CEO kind of was intrigued. John Wilson said, "Well, let's explore this." And a few months later, he had an opportunity to give a speech, and I put together some words for him, and I put in a paragraph or two about sustainable development. And the following day, the National Post featured an editorial headlining "Something New from the Mining Industry." And Wilson just said, "I think we've got something here, so let's go forward with it." So we intensified our external communications and dialogue with the NGO community to find out what would it really take for a mining company to be able to project itself as an adherent of sustainable development. We did an enormous amount of internal consultation. I went around to different mining operations of ours in Papua New Guinea and elsewhere. And we sat through discussing, you know, what really would we be doing differently if we adopt sustainable development, where in some places like Papua New Guinea, they were doing just about everything imaginable to manage their environmental and political risks. So they said, "Well, I don't think we'd be doing much differently, but we'd be sort of looking at what we're doing differently, right? Describing it differently." other places maybe had a few more challenges that we'd have to catch up with, particularly with respect to indigenous peoples who largely have been ignored in Canada at that time by the mining industry. But eventually, we came to an internal corporate consensus that we could live with this. And in February, I remember it very clearly, of 1997, after a final major strategic meeting of about 100 or more people from operations all around the world, hammering out the final words and phrases of what everybody thought they could live with within this sustainable development policy, we brought it to our board. It was very interesting. I can remember some of the linguistic debates that we had, which from a philosopher's perspective, as I then thought I possessed, probably did and still do, were very interesting. It was around the issue of using the term human rights. Now, we had operations in Chile, and the operational management in Chile were very concerned that we started in 1997, which was, only 8 years after Pinochet's regime, espousing human rights as one of the core elements of sustainable development, we would immediately be branded as anti-Pinochetistas in Chile. This would politicize our role in that country to a degree that would be very difficult.
Would that have been a bad thing, though?
Well, it would have put you, if you're operating in a country which has a high level of political sensitivities around certain areas, such as human rights, in those days, has now evolved. Now, the mining industry, for a whole range of reasons, which I can describe later if you wish, has moved way beyond its nervousness around human rights. But human rights was regarded as placing you very much in the political domain, and so there was this set of issues that corporate management had about being in a foreign country and getting that deeply involved in the politics of that country. It's ironically about the same time frame Shell was going through this situation in Nigeria with Ogoniland and the issue around Ken Sarawita, the philosopher-poet that was hanged by the military government at the time, and learning lessons that, you probably had to get involved in some degree of human rights because, not being involved while you have so much power and influence over eventualities was maybe irresponsible. In Chile, it was different. It's not that Chile had significant human rights issues. It was that the society was deeply divided as to whether the Pinochet regime had been overall, it obviously had some very serious deficiencies of specific sorts related to human rights, but overall had been better for Chile or not. And the company did not want to find itself put into one camp, which was primarily the left-wing camp in Chile, with respect to that set of issues, simply by saying that we support basic human rights as enunciated by United Nations Universal Declaration, let us say. So it would have politicized the company from their point of view, but where we ended up was, I said, at one point I said, well, all we're talking about here is fundamental freedoms, freedom from persecution, freedom from arbitrary arrest, Well, then they said, you can use that term. Fundamental freedoms doesn't resonate in Chile in any manner. So there we just put that in our policy that the company, undertook to operate in conformity with fundamental freedoms. And the term fundamental freedoms actually, occurs in U.S. United Nations documents as well. So that was an example of the kind of wordsmithing that we had to get through, which wasn't just a matter of wordsmithing, it was a matter of, holistic, contextual kind of thinking with respect to the implications of the words that you use. Those implications, have all sorts of ramifications that both concrete and philosophical that that are very good to be aware of. So it was a very significant awareness raising exercise by Placer Dome's management and senior employees with respect to this broad set of issues, which were, the challenges that the company had to deal with. It went to our board of directors in February of 1997, the draft policy. And amazingly, the board took out certain weasel words. We had certain words in there like may or could, and they put in will. Okay. I said, what have we done? They made it stronger. And so there we were. We were the first and only mining company at the time to have a corporate policy that integrated our industrial activities with a broad set of concepts around sustainable development. It was not only a policy, but it was a set of specific objectives for the different mining initiatives that we had around the world. It was a commitment to various reporting procedures and protocols. And it was a commitment also stated in our first draft of the policy to work within the industry to bring others along in the same direction. And one of the things that was not surprising, actually, is that once we had adopted this policy of sustainable development, we attracted a certain amount of attention from the NGOs, many of whom had actually been allies encouraging us to go this way. Now they said, well, now we're going to make sure that you live up to it. And so we were probably submitting ourselves to more pressure. It was almost like we had raised a flag. Everybody started shooting at it. And coincidentally, I was involved from 1992 onwards with this organization, which was then called, it was founded in 1992, the International Council on Metals and the Environment. And for its first 7-8 years, it was headquartered here in Ottawa. And the founding of the organization took place largely at the effort of Canadian mining companies, particularly Inco and Falconbridge and Aranda in those days, none of whom were Canadian mining companies anymore, but anyway, they were leaders in getting this organization started. And I became, after years of serving on this particular committee, I became chair of the Public Policy Committee at the ICME and set as my objective getting the ICME to move in the direction of adopting sustainable development. And there was, again, huge resistance. A lot of the resistance was quite political. Some of the member companies definitely saw sustainable development as being very much a part of the European social democratic policy orientation. And we're not comfortable with that. Some of the UK members, and not so much the UK members, but certainly the US and Australian members were a bit concerned about the left-leaning, apparent left-leaning orientation of sustainable development. They preferred the Adam Smith invisible hand with respect to economic decision making. And so we had a certain amount of resistance. We had a very strong resistance. In fact, I remember around that same time, the late 1990s, the then head of the American Mining Association, General Bernard Lawson, I think his first name was Bernard, who had retired from the U.S. Air Force as a 4-star general. He used to brag about the fact that he learned the art of management from Curtis LeMay. I don't know if you remember General Curtis LeMay, but he was the general during the Kennedy administration, I guess, and probably Johnson administration in the U.S., who wanted to bomb Vietnam back to the Stone Age, and that would resolve the Vietnamese conflict. I remember General Lawson. It was a strange choice to be head of the Mining Association, I always thought, but, you know, he appealed to, I guess, a certain element of mining company management in the United States, made a speech that the mining industry, as he assessed it, was outnumbered. And he says, from his military training, he knew what to do when you were outnumbered by your adversaries. You bring in reinforcements. But he wasn't terribly good at finding reinforcements to bring in, and he gave a speech against sustainable development, which was quite memorable in my mind. I mean, he basically described sustainable development as being reds under the bed, and a sort of subterfuge that would drain Americans of their precious vital fluids, or something to that extent, straight out of Dr. Strangelove. So we had some very significant opposition to this concept of sustainable development. But I had one very good ally, and that was in the World Bank. And the mining technical division of the World Bank was headed then by quite a remarkable individual named Peter van der Veen, a Dutchman who had been a mining engineer with Boliden and maybe some other companies, and had experience in Latin America, particularly in Peru, and was quite sympathetic. In fact, because the World Bank was formerly part of the Sustainable Development Initiative launched by the United Nations, was constantly looking for ways to expand the integration of mining with sustainable development. So Peter and I had a number of conversations on this, and he suggested at one point that we conduct an intensive three-day exercise with the industry to think through all the implications of the concepts embodied within the framework of sustainable development, and see if we could come to some kind of position of accepting the possibility that the mining industry would overall adopt sustainable development as a framework for its activities. So we had this three-day workshop in Washington, D.C., which was indeed very intensive. And we brought in NGOs, we brought in some academics, we had World Bank people, United Nations people, and we had about 20 companies from the ICME represented. And we went through the different elements of sustainable development, you know, whether it was environmental issues, how you would deal with those differently, whether it was social and community issues, even whether it was economic priorities and the challenges of wealth distribution and poverty reduction around mining sites, issues of governance and corruption and so forth. And at the end, the industry caucused, and they had been shaken up a bit by this experience, but they hadn't been totally converted. And I was just trying to sort of muster them in the direction of coming to some sort of consensus and support of maybe moving to the next step, of being very vague here, but of adopting sustainable development. And then finally, a senior member of the committee that I chaired, representing BHP, which is now BHP Billiton, stood up and he said, you know, he says, I don't like the look of sustainable development. I don't like the smell of sustainable development. I don't like the taste of sustainable development. It sticks in my throat, but maybe we have to swallow it for our own good. And then one of the guys said, oh, maybe Roger has a point. No. He retired a couple months later, so perhaps he felt that he was free to make such a radical statement. But I like to say that it was with that degree of enthusiasm that the mining industry crossed the line and said, yeah, let's move the next step towards sustainable development. And I expected it to be a very gradual process, but it wasn't. Once the cat was out of the bag, so to speak, the industry woke up and they said, okay, if we're going to do this, then we've got to just do it, you know, with all engines firing. And so the 10 of the companies met at the World Economic Forum in 1998, I think it was, and decided that they were going to launch a global exercise on mining, minerals, and sustainable development. They went to the World Business Council Sustainable Development in Geneva to provide an umbrella for this exercise and give some detachment so it wouldn't seem to be simply an industry-led initiative, but it would be an independently-led initiative. And the International Institute for Environment and Development was brought on board, a group in London, to conduct global consultations. And there were regional consultations set up in the Americas and other parts of the world. And we went through this period from 1999, 2002, which was a major industry education process of coming to terms with the implications of sustainable development, so that now, 2002, policy was adopted, the summary of the global consultation called Breaking New Ground was issued, and the ICME transferred into the International Council on Mining and Metals, headquartered in London. And that has been a leading institute with respect to advancing the understanding and the implications of the whole range of issues around mining and sustainable development. So it's been quite a major path for the industry to have taken. And I'm fortunate that I was there at the beginning, although I have to say,
Kick-started it.
I kickstarted it. Where sustainable development is concerned, though, as they say, you know, success has 1,000 fathers and failure is an orphan. This succeeded, and so there are many, many people that can claim a lot of credit for making it happen. But I was all alone at one point. I can remember quite well.
I was going to ask you, you had mentioned a lot of the resistance you had gotten, especially from the mining and natural resources communities. But when you first started, because you were technically like a mining guy, was there a lot of resistance from whether it be the media or NGOs or Aboriginals?
Well, I have to say, as far as by that time, you know, Placer had Placer had a complicated relationship with NGOs, but we probably had one of the most intensive relationships with NGOs because we, on the one hand, we were dealing in a defensive mode related to the Marcopper situation. On the other hand, with a proactive mode related to the sustainable development, policy development. And I remember one of the NGOs saying at the time, yeah, we can talk to you. It's just like Vietnam. You can fight and talk at the same time, right? And so we were sort of on the one hand fighting and the other hand talking. And I remember one of the most senior members of the NGO community at one point, he was quite an interesting fellow from Australia, said, you know, in fact, you should interview him. His name is Michael Ray. He's now head of the Organization of Responsible Jewelry Manufacturers. Well, Michael Ray, who then was with WWF, and he was their global mining lead, says, Placer Dome, what you're looking for is peace with honor. And in some respects, I think he was right. It was a complicated situation. There were certainly many, many NGOs that were skeptical about, you know, how far we could take this. And there were some that were more realistic and some that were more idealistic. Obviously, the more realistic ones said, well, you know, improving a mining company is better than trying to make it perfect and failing. So, but there were some that wanted a degree of perfection, which, you know, we weren't able to achieve in those days. There was a lack of consultation with Aboriginal people in those days, I have to say. I mean, if the thing had been done 10 years later, it would have been quite different. And partly that was because the Indigenous peoples around the world, but the Aboriginal communities in Canada particularly, were only beginning to sort of wake up to their potential, A, to be involved, and B, to influence any kind of developments that might occur on the traditional territories. So they really weren't prepared to engage, because they hadn't gone through their own sort of mental developmental process, I think, quite as far as they subsequently have. And we weren't prepared to engage because we operated certain mines that, you know, none of our mines at the time had any kind of relationship with First Nations, with one exception, that would be the the Detour Lake mine and the Musselwhite mine in Northern Ontario had developed some relationships with First Nations. But in BC, there were no relationships. And at the time, we had mines in Quebec as well, and there were no relationships there. So, and the two that I mentioned were, you know, early stage pathfinding kind of relationships. It would have been difficult to move those into a corporate dialogue about the role of the company overall. So that was a deficiency. But, you know, once we had this policy, we were, quite frankly, called hypocrites. And I was even mentioned in the press once as the biggest hypocrite in the mining industry, because I was going around saying, here's our vision, here's what we're trying to do, here's how we see ourselves. This fundamentally is the purpose of mining, sustainable development. And so, you know, how can you believe that? And in a sense, it was only partially true, but it wasn't totally untrue. It's only partially true because we weren't quite measuring up to the ideal that we had set for ourselves. And it was a constantly, that was the whole idea of adopting a policy which was going to be a stretch, right? It was to sort of force you to sort of be aware of an ideal beyond your present level of performance. And there are some people that were nervous about that. you know, a number of years later, I about 7-8 years ago, I encountered a concept which had been introduced by a Norwegian social and political philosopher, Jan Elster, called the civilizing force of hypocrisy. And this became a very important concept in my own mind, because it suddenly caused me to recognize that hypocrisy was not just simply a negative characteristic, that hypocrisy could be a driver of change, and that because hypocrisy causes cognitive dissonance, at some point you either find yourself abandoning the pretense or conforming to the image that you're projecting. And so it does propel evolution. And you know, it was interesting, I gave a speech a couple of months ago to a group of academics from around the world who were involved in teaching engineers about the concept of sustainable development. And I introduced this concept to them, and they had thought of every possible motivator for moving in the direction of sustainable development, except hypocrisy. So the biggest, Jan Elster should have been there. The biggest set of questions I had after this was, tell us more about hypocrisy. How do you do this? Well, hypocrisy is pretty easy to achieve, actually, if you're without, you know, many people do it all the time, particularly in the political realm, I suppose. But anyway, so the NGOs were critical. They did see us as hypocrites, but they continued working with us, and it was always, you know, for almost as long as I was working within the industry, it was sort of a simultaneously fight and talk situation. Still that today. Even today, I've had an email exchange about an event that might take place here later in the year, trying to involve the NGOs and the mining industry. And, you know, is this going to be a constructive dialogue where we actually sort of come to some kind of mutual realization that there are strategies available to improve situations? Or is it simply going to be a platform for protests or name and shame sort of activity? And, you know, there's a very genuine interest on the part of the industry of that realizes that by virtue of the type of industrial activity it's engaged in, and by virtue of the complex socio-environmental challenges that it faces in most of the remote regions where it undertakes this industrial activity, that it needs to find new, more effective approaches to dealing with the issues that it confronts. And so the industry is very oriented to engaging with NGOs if it could be constructive. But what's the benefit of simply being you know, accused of this, that, and the other thing? It satisfies maybe a certain sense of righteousness on the part of the NGOs that level the accusations, but it doesn't really achieve very much. But not all NGOs are in that category. I mean, in fact, it's interesting. Some of the NGOs have sort of developed two sides of their activity. So one is the advocacy side, and the other is the constructive engagement side. You know, and I can name a few that have gone in that direction. But those that remain totally locked on the advocacy side believe that's where their bread and butter is, and that's what they need to do. And maybe they don't really have much in the way of constructive solutions to offer anyway. So what can you say?
Mm-hmm. As of today, if we look at Canada, and this topic comes up once in a while in the interviews I've had, would you say there's still a major disconnect between your mining industries or even your natural resources industries and society and media? And not necessarily just opposition, but a disconnect, maybe a lack of effort between both parties to understand, or even the fact that there's a lack of education between, it could be people and the mining industry, for example.
Hmm. Well, you know, there's a spectrum of understanding. Certainly, most of the industrial world is based in the cities and functions according to a set of economic expectations, sociocultural habits of the industrial, you can even call it the post-industrial age right now. Primarily, everybody's involved in the service economy, right? They work for museums and things like that. But, So with rare exceptions, a museum has taken an interest in something like mining. There's not a large awareness as to what it's all about. I mean, the mining industry, some of its proponents love to say that, you know, just look around you. I mean, most of what you depend on, from the doorknob over there to the structure of the chair you're sitting on, you know, eventually was a mineral in the earth that had to be extracted and refined and so forth to give you the metal that you're making use of. And as I said, you know, from a philosophical point of view, the relationship between humankind and the material universe, which goes back in Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age, you know, right up to now, is a major part of our being. But it's not something that most people reflect on. It's something that you take more or less for granted. I mean, unless you know, unless you're of a mechanical disposition, you have very little knowledge of what's under the hood of your car, right? Doesn't mean anything to you. And that's true, I think, of most people's lives, that they're not aware, really, of the challenges of providing mineral resources for the material universe in which they operate. It's less true, of course, in communities that are closer to the mining operations themselves. Now, they themselves would probably not see the industry in terms of its global holistic role, but more in terms of its immediate impacts, environmentally and socially and so forth, economically, that they experience. So it's a mix. The media, again, you know, there are a few people in the media that maybe have an understanding and sympathy for the complexities and challenges of the mining industry, but not that many. So it's a specialized as far as the sort of intellectual orientation of society is concerned, it's a specialized focus, a specialized sort of set of information. There have been some efforts to get beyond that. I mean, you know, the mining industry itself has been supportive of efforts at the even the grade school level, but particularly high school level, to make sure that, you know, part of one's general knowledge when you finish high school is that you understand how mining fits into everything. And so there's that, but it's, you know, it's just sort of a marginal part of one's education, I think. So, yeah, it is a challenge. I'm not sure, you know, in terms of the activity and the contribution of the industry overall, how important it is that society in general be aware of all these things and be part of the decision processes. I mean, it might be that leaving it to people that are more specialized might actually produce better outcomes. This is a big issue right now, not with mining, but with pipelines in this country. Mm-hmm. Right, and it's a very similar situation.
Yeah, that's why I mentioned natural resources.
Yeah. So it's a very similar situation that the struggle between integrating general public concerns into decisions between leaving it to technical and specialized knowledge, and that balance needs to be found. And the same thing exists with mining. I mean, I think with respect to pipelines, for example, the government of Canada at the present time has gone too far in restricting decision-making to factual and technical inputs and not integrating adequately cultural values and so forth in those decisions, so that, you know, if you really have concerns, and a large part of Canadian society has concerns, that we have to eventually move off fossil fuels, then at least that long-term vision should be part of the backdrop of the consideration with respect to pipelines, which means that, you know, the decision to build a pipeline, and this is true with mining right now, but not with pipelines as far as I'm concerned, should be integrated with the prospect of decommissioning pipelines. We don't build mines today without thinking of the end of the mine.
Yeah.
Maybe because we know that ore bodies are depletable. It will definitely, as a course of nature, come to cease producing. You think you build a pipeline, you're building something that has no end. Well, if indeed, you know, the orientation of society is, and even some of the major thinkers about energy futures are saying, you know, by 2050, even there was even a speech by somebody in Saudi Arabia recently, you know, we're going to be phasing out of fossil fuels. Those values, those perspectives should be part of the integration, the decision process, and to limit it simply to the specialist, the scientific and technical and factual inputs with respect to immediate impacts and the development of engineering challenges of developing the project is far too narrow and a socially irresponsible approach to making major decisions, in my view.
We'll finish on one question. You had a very prolific career. What do you do now?
Well, you know, it's interesting. In terms of titles and so forth, I have 3 academic appointments. One is an adjunct professor to the Mining Engineering Department at UBC. My main activity there has been in being part, major part of the preparation and submission of a proposal to develop the Canadian International, what's now called the Canadian International Resources and Development Institute. The initial phrase was the Canadian International Institute for Extractive Industries and Development. This was in response to a request for proposals from the Government of Canada, from universities to put in submissions for establishing such an institute. We did that at UBC, and another academic appointment I have is an adjunct professor at the BD School of Business at Simon Fraser, where I've been active in initiating something called the Responsible Mineral Resource Initiative, RMSI. Brought those two together, RMSI, or BD School of Business, with the mining engineering faculty at UBC, and we made our submission, and we won a $25 million award, along with commitments for about another $7.5 million or so from partners that wanted to be part of this initiative. Major partners simply joined as one of the 3 coalition universities, and that's the École Polytechnique de Montréal. I have been chair of the advisory council to this initiative since it got started 2 years ago. It's been very slow getting off the ground. It's been somewhat frustrating to those of us that thought that more could be achieved sooner than has been done. But it still has potential, I think, and I'm still remaining in the mix with respect to trying to make it succeed. I'm also, I hold an appointment at McGill University, the Institute of Study of International Development, as Professor of Practice in Global Governance. And I was in residence at McGill for the second half of 2013, conducted a forum on Aboriginal issues and mining, and also taught a course there, a graduate course on gold, gold, guns, and governance, we called it, which is about anticipating and dealing with conflict around mining industries. But the major demand for me over the past year or so has been related to a concept that I introduced into mining quite separately from the Sustainable Development Initiative, which I discussed, and that's the concept of social license to operate. And it's interesting that that's become so prominent, because when I introduced the term, for me it was just a way of describing a certain situation that had evolved, and it was done at a conference at the World Bank in March of 1997. When they convened a group to discuss the next 25 years of mining, and my subject being political risk. Where was managing political risk going to be going over the following 25 years? And this, again, is from the perspective of 1997. Simultaneously, we were working on sustainable development, but I didn't talk about sustainable development in this event. I talked just about a more narrow conception of political risk and the fact that globalization was doing 2 things. Globalization as a concept was just that emerging, and one thing, it was reducing barriers to entry for foreign capital investing in mining, and so you had a lot more transboundary operations of international mining companies. And 2, it was moving in the direction of more rapid communications around the world, instant knowledge about anything that happened anywhere for anyone that wanted to know what it was. And that was the very early days before the huge development of social media that has subsequently taken place. But in those days, there was a story which I initially heard of the World Bank, of a mining company that had this amazing experience. They'd been working on an exploration project in Papua New Guinea, and they'd reached an agreement with the local landowners around the site where they were exploring. And a few months later, they were talking to a tribe in Brazil about a possible exploration project, and the tribe in Brazil says, "We want the same deal you gave those people in Papua New Guinea." And this seemed astounding, you know. Yeah. Nobody would think twice about that kind of story today. I mean, you just get it by Twitter. even if you're buried in some remote village in some kind of tribal community. But in those days it was new. And what that meant was that in many developing countries, the local communities where we were operating were isolated, in a sense, not just physically, but politically, from the governments of the countries. And so we would go in there, and the government would basically say, "Well, you know, don't worry about local community." And we were down there, and we realized that, you know, we couldn't ignore the local community. And the fact that they were developing these international connections meant that they were beginning to have allies in the NGO community and among churches, media, academics, and so forth. And so we had to take all of that a lot more seriously. And so I said, "Well, you know, when we deal with the government, we're trying to get a government permit. So when we're dealing with local communities," I said, "let's call it a social license." I mean, it's larger than a community permit, because it's not just the community, it's a community plus its international allies. So that's the social license that we have to earn. And so I introduced this term purely as a point of reference for pragmatic political risk management. That we had to work at two levels, locally, and because we were on a two-track approval process for major mining processes, locally and nationally. And but it was very quickly picked up by some of my friends in the NGO world that said, "Wow," he said, this is a way of empowering communities." And so they moved this simple concept from sort of a pragmatic reference point on political risk management to an ethical concept. We start talking about the ethics of corporations. So you have corporate social responsibility, which requires that it works with communities in order to achieve the social license or the sustainable development framework, then sort of brought in social license, although not during the MMSD period, it's interesting to note, not until later. Or it invested communities with certain fundamental rights. So it transferred the focus of concern from the corporation attempting to get its relationships with communities on a sustainable and non-conflictual basis to the community's right to have what now become in many cases free, prior, informed consent before any project can progress and so forth. But then more recently, the term social license has become totally detached from immediate local impacts. And it started referring to any kind of issue where the national approval process does not adequately include other public concerns. So this refers back to the discussion we just had on pipelines, that the government might want to reduce the consultative arena simply to factual and technical input and not receive input related to other extraneous, as it would regard them, extraneous concerns, such as climate change, let's say, or biodiversity impacts or something, and the oceanic impacts. And the result is that we say, "Well, you know, you may have government permission for this, but you do not have social license." And you even recently, both Justin Trudeau and Thomas Mulcair have talked about certain policies of the government where Stephen Harper doesn't have social license. Well, this is not at all the way in which the term was meant to be used when I introduced it. I mean, as I say, some of the expansion of the meaning in terms of vesting, you know, ethical content in communities and corporations and so forth, as opposed to just pure political risk pragmatism, I can understand and accept, because we're still talking about managing local impacts. But when you start talking about these general concerns, you're no longer talking about managing local impacts. I think you're dealing with more broad public policy issues, which I think go beyond the scope of the term social license, right? So that's that's perhaps a misuse of a concept, at least if it were up to me, I would not use it that way. So as a result, I've been interviewed many times over the past year, you know, by radios and newspapers and so forth, on this subject of social license. And that's a good part of how I've been spending the last 12 months. Anyway.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Had enough?
Have you?
Yeah, I guess I have.
Yeah, no, thank you.
Yeah, it's always good to trot out an old war horse and hear whether he can still neigh or not.
Yeah, I know. Quite a few interesting stories. So thank you very much.
Well, maybe you can edit that into something useful.